Okay, everyone, we're ready to resume the meeting. So before I continue to the discussion around the amendments put on the table prior to the adjournments, I think Councillor Gilchrist has something he'd like to propose.
I spoke to a number of members in the interval. The reason for this is where we started, as you know, consultations with groups and consultations with libraries are about to start. I've produced a wording which I think covers the issues coming forward to us, and I'd like to start with an introduction, or I'll take it whenever members want it adding. Members should be kept fully informed of the response to all consultations so that the proposals brought forward tonight are seen in context, and that developments involving community asset transfer are assessed by the Policy and Resources Committee in due course. I would move that.
Second.
Thank you.
Second.
Said that before I asked. Okay. So we've got that as a to throw into the mix now. And what we will do for members of the public here, so we're going to have a general discussion on what's on the table previously, and then that will be included. Councillor Gilchrist will also be included. Then we'll go to voting.
Just on Councillor Gilchrist's amendment, or whatever it is at this stage, are we not sure by putting those elements in that it's going to add to unnecessary delays and giving us all this stuff? That's why.
I would like an assurance that it doesn't, from an officer.
Could you repeat that?
I was looking for the chair, Councillor Gilchrist.
Thank you, Chair. I think it's in your computer, Chair, over posted to you. It says, members should be kept fully informed of the response to all consultations so that the proposals brought forward tonight are seen in context, and that developments involving community asset transfer are assessed by the Policy and Resources Committee in due course.
I think we could have some brief updates on where we're up to with community asset transfer, but I don't want it to be onerous.
I think, Chair, that we will bring the community asset transfer policy back to Policy and Resources Committee next month in March for the members to agree. There'll be a criteria in that policy and there'll be some timelines in there. So I think at that point, potentially, we would agree then that there will be a process, a timeline process in there as to when there potentially will be a cut-off. Because I think in my opinion that we would need some sort of cut-off for expressions of interest. It will take a while to have expressions of interest, then we would need to analyse the business cases, get them validated. And then there is a bit of a time then for agreeing things like leases and heads of terms, so it could take a while. So I think if I bring that back as part of the policy that comes to the committee in March, and then we can agree a cut-off process there then, if that would help.
Yes, I think that helps. The words in due course can be taken to mean March and beyond, in whichever appropriate forum.
Thanks, Councillor Gilchrist. Thank you. Okay, so we're just going to move on to a general discussion now. And we're going to open it up. So I would like to see Councillor Robinson. Put your hands up.
Is it general discussion?
Yeah, on all of the amendments.
Thank you, Chair. I'd just like to sort of say, if I can, about the Woodchurch Leisure Centre. In 2019, we actually had a full costed business plan for the leisure centre and swimming pool, which obviously we worked with leisure services at the time and obviously with the community. Had meetings in the Carbridge Centre on the Woodchurch and some local residents. Then, obviously, as we know, COVID hit, which changed a lot of things for everybody, and the centre became a vaccine centre with the understanding or the belief that it would reopen in April this year. And also as an aquatic centre. In the interim of that period, obviously, we've had the CIFRA reports, and we've also had, obviously, Ada Burns reports. And then the demolition came up of the Woodchurch Leisure Centre. In the, once that obviously became, the proposal came forward, there's been maintenance, obviously, a lot of meetings going on, a lot of discussions. I'd like to sort of also put my personal thanks, obviously, to everyone that signed the petition, the 5,000 residents tonight. I'd also like to also thank yourself as well as the leader for all your support in the background and also in meetings and sort of advocacy and trying to help and support this, obviously, for the community. Not just the board chair, as we said before, which Tisha mentioned, it's also the wider community, the schools and everything else. So I would implore that the PNR do support this, obviously, to give it a fighting chance and opportunity to be able to pursue all avenues that we can in the period. Thank you.
Thanks, Dean. And thank you for that. What you said, very kind words. It's really, really important to me, not only as the representative of a valuable community asset, but it's where I went to school. I imagine where it's a lot of people went to school, and where my daughter went to school. So thank you for those kind words. Councillor Stewart, you were next.
Thanks, Chair. I've got a couple of points, one specific question as well, the relevant officer. So, just in support of the motion that Councillor Anderson put forward with regards to having a guarantee that there will be no building on the golf courses, I just wanted to comment with regards to the work that the Babington councillors have done over years, both past and present councillors, the determination to ensure that Brackenwood is not built upon, and to retain Brackenwood as a golf course is obviously the ideal solution for most people. However, you know, this motion that I agreed to second, or I came into second earlier, is, you know, proposing that whatever the outcome, which is still to be determined with regards to Brackenwood, that the residents in that area and in the other golf course as well will be protected as being built and will be protected from development. And as I say, while the outcome of the future of Brackenwood isn't certain, with this motion we can at least offer a guarantee that this will stay as Greenbelt and Green Space accessible to all the public. And just want to sort of comment and commend on the various environmental projects that will still continue despite the cuts that were, you know, unfortunately happened to make here this evening and at full council. You know, we've managed rewilding, managed parks and open spaces that will then, you know, obviously encourage habitats and birds, insects, butterflies, you know, all of that. Just with regards to the libraries, I am in support of both the amendments there this evening, but I just want to seek some reassurance with regards, and I'm going to be absolutely sort of my part now. I would just like some reassurance from officers, if officers can confirm that Seacombe Library today, as we opened for the first time since the pandemic started, and it's been reopened and relocated into the Children's Centre in St Paul's Road. And I just want officers to confirm that there are no plans to close Seacombe Library, and that residents will not lose their access to the internet, computers and IT facilities, and neither are there any plans to do so.
Thank you. Thanks, Councillor Stewart. So, David,
are
you able to respond to the
library's
question?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Just happy to confirm that the library provision in Seacombe is not proposed for closure in the current approved consultation document. Thank you.
Councillor Gray, you
had
your hand up next.
Thanks, Chair. In a way, it's echoing and expanding on what's been said previously. I would also personally like to thank you for your work in giving Woodchurch another chance. I know how much it means to you, and it means a lot to a lot of people. So that's just my personal advice there. I also wanted to refer to the various different people who've stepped in to try and save the golf land, and how many people care about that golf land. And I know that Councillor Cameron has already said, she's made it very clear in her comprehensive answers that her committee will investigate all options fairly and thoroughly, and I just want responded to well from that, and it doesn't surprise me because I know how Councillor Campbell works. Should a sustainable alternative to golf prove elusive, which it might do, I think it's really important tonight that we do clearly reassure all residents that we are considering all the alternatives, and that much loved green open spaces would be safe from development, so I welcome what's been put forward. It is possible that these open spaces, instead of generating loss, could generate revenue, and there's a whole host of really quite interesting alternatives that could be considered, such as allotments, opening it up for walking where it's not open at the moment. Golf courses are not completely open, you don't have a complete right to roam. This would reduce the pressure on our SSSIs and other areas that are currently being overused, because people have understandably acquired a real love of nature and the outdoors during the pandemics. We could even open them up to cycling. I know that we've had trouble with illicit use of cycle tracks, young people literally taking spades to some of our designated sites, and how we have to intervene to stop that. We could work with them with the design cycle tracks, and it could be completely legitimate. And alongside, as has already been mentioned, rewilding, tree planting, if we had an enhanced catering offer in some of these places that was attractive to the public, this could help to bring in revenue. And I know that some of our residents, a number of our residents, drive considerably long distance outside the borough to access family adventure trails in Cheshire, in wider Merseyside. These are all options that would help keep this land green and open. And if it's generating a revenue, surely it's safer than if it's generating a loss. It's less likely to end up being developed on. And I think that one of the main things that most of our residents are concerned about is that this land is kept green and open. So I really do welcome the moves to protect this land. I also welcome the moves to ensure that the golf groups have time and space to see if they can find a sustainable alternative. And it just needs to be made really clear to residents that none of us, I think, wants an either or of golf or abandonment, that there are lots of viable options. And I have faith in Councillor Cameron that she will scrutinise those and take that forward. Thank you very much. Thanks, Chair.
I agree. I think Councillor Cameron is tasked with a big ask here, but it is really important to take on board all of the proposals that come our way, but whilst at the same time giving that commitment that we're not going to build on any of our green lands. So there's so many hands up at the moment, so I'm just going to start making a list. Do forgive me. Councillor McManus was next, and then Councillor Cameron. Okay. I'll bring in Councillor McManus first.
Thank you, Chair. I just wanted to thank the two Labour councillors in Babington and all those who attended the public meeting at Brockenwood last week, and I know many of you are here this evening. I think it's really important that we allow that full consultation to run its course. Nothing has been decided. And I'm delighted that the Labour group are asking for expressions of interest to from a community-run body. One option presented in the evening was from an organisation, a CIC, a community interest company, Love Golf Manchester, who actually offer community outreach, free golf lessons to young people, food provision during the school summer holidays. And this organisation has already taken on Rochdale and Heaton Park golf courses in Manchester, so they do have a track record. The other issue I just wanted to discuss was the antisocial behaviour review. I'm really pleased to see that has been addressed, Chair. There are pockets of antisocial behaviour across the borough, in particular in some of our most deprived wards. Quite regularly, we're having emails from our local police force to tell us of dispersal zones that have been enacted. I have very recent personal experience of antisocial behaviour when my 54-year-old Volkswagen Beetle had all its windows smashed. Fortunately, no one was injured, but I do have great empathy with some of our residents who live with this cowardly behaviour, as I threat, so I really welcome that. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Councillor McManus. Councillor Cameron, you were left on the list.
Yes, thanks. I wasn't going to speak specifically, having had so many questions, but I also don't believe that sustainability, increasing biodiversity, is mutually exclusive to a golf course. So they can be explored also in tandem as well as separately. And I was really heartened to hear how many people had attended that meeting, because that was possibly the biggest shock when I decided to run for election, that it was a greenbelt parcel, that Mark McDonald were deciding how many houses would be built on it. So now we're all in agreement and it's in a greenbelt. I just wanted to qualify, I think you said if it's earning an income, it's less likely to be a threat to being developed. And I just desperately wanted to make sure we all understand the greenbelt boundary has been drawn. We're so close to going to that local plan forward. It is absolutely greenbelt. So an income generation isn't a consideration in terms of our local plan and that greenbelt boundary that covers Brackenwood Golf Course and the Poulton Recreation Field that's next to it. So it is currently in the greenbelt, it remains in the greenbelt. It's that obviously in this proposal there's also Hoy Lake, and Councillor Anderson quite rightly wanted to put an extra level of comfort in there. But it's never been, does it earn income or not? That's never been a consideration in terms of when it was originally a greenbelt parcel. And so I'm just so relieved that we're all on the same page with that, that it actually is a greenbelt and should firmly stay there.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not going to bring you back in, but I'm not going to put words in your mouth either. I don't think that's what you meant, because we're fully supportive of the proposal not to build at all. Councillor Anderson, you're next.
I won't repeat what Councillor Cameron just said. I was just going to say it's great that all policies now can finally agree to the Greenbelt policy and protecting those sites, and that Helen's just said what I was going to say.
Thank you. Councillor Gilchrist.
Thank you, Chair. Before former Councillor Musprat left the Council, I gave her a copy of Bimbleton Town Guide from about 1972, one of the last produced by Bimbleton Council, where they said how proud they were to have their golf course at Brackenwood. And Christina surprised that possession that I gave her, because you know, it was only going to sit on my shelves. So, yeah, there's a long history to this. There was pride, civic pride in Bimbleton at the time. We are about to discuss the 21st of March, I think it is, the local plan. Having read the document, I think we're all sort of speaking from the same sheet about the document and what we hope it will contain. We live in a rather uncertain world of climate change, so all our policies have to take account of the need for rewilding and changing the environment that we've destroyed over time. Just wanted to touch on what I said earlier about the consultation. We're starting a library consultation tonight. We've had some good advance notice of certain community groups who are well-formed, well-organised. I hope that as time goes on, we'll get proposals from others we can study. The final plea is to planning and anyone else that adult care have a clear view that we want to have more care centres in the right place, meeting needs to help us invest to save in the future and meet the needs of our growing elderly population.
Thanks, Councillor Gilchrist, for going forward. I'd like to try and keep the discussion to the amendments that come on the table. Councillor Nolan, you're left on the list.
Thanks, Chair. I'll be brief. Obviously, delighted that we have the proposal that Rock Ferry Library and most of us will be continuing. Hopefully, that will be agreed. But I'm also really pleased to see in the level of amendment the proposal to retain the existing structure of the antisocial behaviour team. This is a major issue, without any doubt, in many of our communities. In fact, I guess if I say in all of our communities, in one way or another, it is a huge issue, and it's one that we really do need to tackle, and so I'm really supportive of that. We managed to find the resources to keep that in there. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Tony Jones.
Thanks, Chair. Mine's just a very brief comment about the community asset transfer policy or report. And you've already alluded to it being an equitable process. I think it's long overdue for elected members and officers to be able to work to written policy documents that is fair, transparent, and just what is needed to benefit the residents of Wirral in general, and any groups or organisations who have an interest in asset transfer. And I'm really looking forward to receiving the document in a timely manner. Thanks, Chair.
Okay, did I have anyone else that wished to speak?
Yes, thanks, Chair. So, a few comments from myself. We're disappointed that Labour deservedly didn't share their proposals beforehand. Unlike myself and Councillor Gilchrist, that would have been the collegiate thing to do. I'm also concerned that, in terms of the libraries, that you know we're cherry picking here. You know, there's some libraries that are obviously particularly important to members of this committee, but people watching in Brenton, Romborough, Bevington, etc., they'll be wondering, well, why, you know, why are these libraries being singled out for special attention? So definitely concerned about that. In terms of my own suggestion, you know, we do have a social welfare assistance fund at the moment. It has been significantly boosted by the community outbreak management funds. That is already there. That's not, of course, to say that there isn't a real need out there. But I would point out that, you know, the climate emergency budget has been very successful, both in reducing costs within the council, for example, the fleet management review is delivering significant cost savings, and in bringing in more funds, like through the tree planting program. And it is obviously there, ready to be supported. There's no additional administrative cost. So I would just make those points. And, you know, it is always the case, isn't it, that, you know, whatever further is said about declaring the climate emergency, when push comes to shove, the environment gets shunted out. So, yeah, I think that's it. Thanks.
Okay. But as you've indicated, you wish to speak, and you're the chair of the Climate Emergencies Committee, so do you want to comment on that?
Just to reassure anybody watching who will have an understandable concern about the Climate Emergency Fund, we have been very, very successful this year in getting external funding, and that has enabled us to do everything that we planned and more in terms of biodiversity and climate actions that were planned. We can't guarantee that every year, and so I am really pleased that there's been a commitment to keep the climate emergency in full from now on. That's really important. I do agree with you there. That is very, very important. Just to reassure everybody that might have a concern about that, that the council has declared a climate emergency and is doing everything that they said they would do and more. So that's just a reassurance. Thank you.
And that's precisely what it is. I think it's reassuring because if, as you have the current chair, you're saying that you believe that the budget for the 1 year, obviously to be increased after that, plus additional external funding that's coming our way, will enable whatever chair that committee going forward has on their agenda will enable to carry it out. And you know, that's good to hear. And I personally think, given the funding to people who are not going to be able to keep their homes at this point in time, the better decision. That's a personal opinion. Councillor McManus, did you want to come back in before we close this discussion?
Just very quickly, I didn't think Badminton Library was closing. Can we have some confirmation on that, please?
It's higher Badminton, Chair. Badminton Library in the city centre is not close to closure. It's higher Badminton Library.
Okay, so everyone's spoken who wanted to. Can we move to the webinar? Do we?
So members of the public, there is a series of votes now. So there is an original motion, which is the officer's recommendations, plus those additional
items added by Councillor Williamson, as that's what stands on the table, that will be voted on last. But before then, there is a series of amendments which have been made, each one requiring a separate vote. Two from Councillor Anderson. Councillor Gilchrist is dependent on the outcome of that. An amendment from Councillor Cleary, which has in itself been challenged, so with the meeting's permission, that will be voted on in parts. The first part about income, the second part about expenditure. Subject to the outcome of that, there is Councillor Stewart's amendment about that expenditure. Finally then, Councillor Gilchrist's amendment added when the meeting resumed. And once we've got to the end of all of that, there will be the final vote on the substantive motion.
So, the first vote is?
On Councillor Anderson's amendment concerning finance.
As amended?
As altered.
Yeah.
So that's what we're voting on. So can I ask all those in favour to raise their hands, please? Against?
Next vote is Councillor Anderson's amendment concerning the intent on golf courses and the green belt.
All those in favour? I'm against.
Thank you, that's unanimous. Councillor Gilchrist's amendment clashed with the earlier one, so it falls away. Then address the first part of Councillor Cleary's amendment concerning the raising of additional income or saving.
Those in favour?
That's unanimous, Chair. And then the second part of Councillor Cleary's concerning the direction of that money.
All those in favour? Against?
That falls, Chair. So then Councillor Stewart's amendment also concerning the direction of those funds.
In favour?
Councillor Gilchrist's last amendment concerning update on the community asset transfer.
All those in favour?
Which finally, Chair, brings you to a substantive motion on the draft budget. Votes on it, Chair.
So that's really group amendments. All those in favour? Is it?
That's the
as amended.
Yes, the entire.
All those in favour as amended.
Yes.
All of it.
Yes, the substantive motion as it stands. That's unanimous, Chair.
It's not.
Sorry, I do apologise.
Against. That brings us to the end of the item. I want to thank everyone for the debate, the discussion, the amendments, bearing with us while we've got the process, some of us. Just because it's the meeting though, so we've still got all the items to finish for now. I'm going to make a plea here that we can get through these as painlessly as possible. In fact, could we do another block? Yes. So we'll take the remaining items on the block, thanks. Thank you, Chair. So there are four items left for this evening. The first one is the capital programme.
refer to the proposal, the report that you've just voted on, however this is capital as opposed to revenue. The three items after this, actually quite pertinent to take them on block, because the three items after this, which are the capital strategy, treasury strategy and the investment strategy, are all intrinsically linked. So that they are all related to the cash flow, the borrowing and the investment activities of the organisation. One actually doesn't stand up without the other because, as I say, they all have a relationship with each other. In terms of the capital programme, which is the first report, this is a 5-year rolling programme. This is aligned to the Wirral Plan, the medium-term financial strategy, and it includes the schemes within the capital programme under the criteria that is quite specific for bids into the capital programme, which is health and safety works, investor save, or schemes that are strategic importance to the council. In terms of the programme, it's made up of bids that are already established as part of the this year's programme, which is 21-26, and also new bids that are included in for next year. And these total 8.96 million, which is included in the recommendations. So these are the new bids that require borrowings. There are additional bids into the capital programme, which are fully funded. And as a principle, we would always try and aim to identify external funding for any bids or schemes that we have in the capital programme. And we have been very successful in bidding for and being awarded significant sums of funding for these schemes in the past. These are detailed in the report in sections 3.26 to 3.31. Just in terms of the capital programme for next year, there is a forecast for the generation and use of capital receipts from asset disposals. And capital receipts are allowable to be used for revenue under the flexible use of capital receipts scheme, which the government has actually extended for another 3 years from next year, 22-23. And under this scheme, funding for capital receipts can be used to support transformation activities, and we will align staffing who are supporting those transformation activities to the use of those capital receipts. Past 23-24, the year 23-24, there isn't any forecast of capital receipts to be used for transformation. And this is because DLUHC have requested us to use any receipts from asset disposals to pay off the loan for capitalisation and also to fund our capital programme. I am aware that the capital receipts, the use of capital receipts guidance is actually changing imminently. We haven't received that guidance yet. But as yet, we do not anticipate that this would have an impact on the way that we use capital receipts for next year. Just in terms of a section that we have in the capital programme report, I just wanted to alert members to. So earlier in the year, a request was submitted to earmark a proportion of capital receipts to be used for a member's capital community fund. However, since the request was made, there has obviously subsequently been the request from DLUHC to utilise any capital receipts over the budget target that we already have to repay the loan for capitalisation. And in looking at identifying some sort of capital pot for members to use in terms of a community fund, we have had engagement with all of the group party leaders as to about how we would allocate this. However, the engagement has actually not resulted in one consistent approach. So every sort of approach was different. The request from each group leader was different. And without having a unified approach, it would really create some sort of unnecessary administrative burden to carry this on. And what I don't want is wouldn't want it to contradict the criteria that we already have established in the programme for bidding for capital. Therefore, within the capital programme, there's been no funding agreed for this next year. That doesn't say, though, that members can still access the current capital programme by bidding for individual projects. Just to highlight, in the capital report, table 6 on page 455, it includes the revenue implications within the capital programme for the new schemes that are included, and those have been built into the medium-term financial plan and the budget report that you've already just agreed. The recommendations in the capital report, Chair, are for all three reports, actually, are onward approval to full council. The capital report specifically is to approve the new bids of the capital programme, to approve any new grant funding schemes to be included within the programme,
once written confirmation that those grants is received, and also to for myself to bring you back regular monitoring reports on a quarterly basis to this committee. And just in terms of the capital financial financing strategy, as I say, the treasury management strategy and the investment strategy, these are all narrative documents. They are, as I say, strategies. And what these three papers do is actually set the principles in terms of how we go about investing in our activities, borrowing activities, and also how we actually manage our cash flow. So I suppose if you wanted to take all of these items on block, I won't go through these individually. These three reports, the latter three reports, are statutory reports that we have to present on an annual basis to full council. I'll just pause there, Chair, and ask if anybody wants to ask any questions on these. Councillor Robinson.
Sorry, Shane, could you just go back to the capital for the asset transfer, please, just to clarify? I know you're saying there's nothing put in next year. But obviously, and obviously a business case can be put forward, but obviously it can't be unlimited. So I'm just concerned there isn't any sort of amount. I appreciate there's been discussion of leaders and stuff. It's just that there's nothing actually in the actual capital programme or anything at all. So can you just expand a little bit on that, please? Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Councillor Robinson. So this wasn't specifically for community asset transfers. This was a request that came forward earlier on in the year, which was about having a pot of funding available for members to utilise on some sort of basis. And this is what we couldn't get to the bottom of. Was it on an individual member basis? Was it on a constituency basis? Was it on a ward member basis? Because there was so much inconsistency, and we couldn't actually get a unified decision. We haven't actually included anything specifically for that. So it doesn't relate specifically to community asset transfers. Okay. It's a general pot.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for clarification.
I think that will have to be revisited after the budget, to be honest. It seems how we couldn't get consistency across anyone. Okay. Councillor Cameron.
Thanks, Chair. Just a quick one. So we just amended the budget saving proposal. I just want to reassure everybody, or I'd like some reassurance of everybody else, that the exciting plans for the 3G AstroTurf pitch at Woodside, at Woodchurch, aren't compromised by the management of how we're going to do this, because you know it's really difficult to build something when you know you've got to demolish. So we've amended in terms of how to manage it, but I want to know that the capital for the, in fact I think it says, a supersized 3G pitch and sporting pavilion, there's no impact on that.
I mean, I can say now no, but I'll bring Councillor Robinson briefly, Councillor.
It's, well, I mentioned before, in 2019, one of the things that was pursued was the 3G, obviously the 3G pitch with the pavilion, which the FA required. The leisure centre was in the same business case. So it doesn't impact, the leisure centre doesn't impact on the 3G.
Okay,
yeah, it's only, sorry, the question really was for officers about the timings. David, we really can go straight ahead with this, can't we? There's no hindrance to it. David.
Thank you, Chair. The two schemes are entirely separate. So there's no thank you. You know, in all respects.
Jeff, did you have your hand up?
It was basically to ask up the other party leaders, because I can remember, it must be 6 months more ago, when Tom raised the idea of using parts of capital receipts for these sales to support local community groups. I was unaware of any discussions had been going on, nor did I know that apparently no one could agree on the way it should be handled. So I'm somewhat disappointed with party leaders, or officers were not bringing them together, knocking their heads together. So
there's just some things we can't agree on, isn't there? That's the bottom line on this one. I'm going to bring Councillor Gilchrist in, then Councillor Anderson.
Thank you. I can confirm that we did talks with officers who collected our views, and perhaps as the views were collated and report back to us, we can look at it again. But I really want to discuss about the capital programme. I mentioned earlier that on page 470, there is 660,000 in the Leisure Capital Improvement Programme. And we had a report that went to the committee, which I think Councillor Cameron will be familiar with. It told us just by how much Knight, Cavanagh and Page found needed spending on our sports centres. So I'd be grateful when the committee has done
any comments, I was going to bring it back up, but since it's all been mentioned and my former leader's expressed his disappointment, I thought I'd just
let me down
clarify the situation. I'm actually quite disappointed, actually, that it's been presented that leaders couldn't agree on a capital pot, a small piffling really capital pot in compared to other council's budget, when we've just tonight managed to agree a balanced budget. Not all parties, sadly, but most of us for the first time. So it really is. It should have come back to leaders as a group. We can discuss that. It was my original proposal that we top slice. So a question from me is that not available due to what were the thoughts of the independent panel? Or can we have a small amount top sliced off sales to put in a community fund to then decide how we allocate it?
I remember the discussions, I think it was pre-anything
else,
so maybe we were working together.
It was, but what is it? We can't have it because it needs to pay the capitalisation, yeah, we can't have it because we can't agree.
We'll revisit it, Councillor Anderson. We're not able to top sales capital receipts because they look and instructed us to use all capital receipts available to pay out the capitalisation, but we can revisit a capital pot.
Who's going to hands up? So what I'm going to do is move that we agree to all the recommendations on what by assent. So I've got we've got a seconder. Thank you. Agreed.
Agreed.
Agreed. Agreed. Thank you. We've got one more item, and I've already expressed my concern. Mr. McCall keeps this snappy, so.
There's a contradiction in terms. The final report, members, is the recommendation to Council, which describes the budget and budget procedure. Essentially, it's the process to be followed up to and during the Budget Council meeting, set out on the very final page on 547. Any questions?
Okay. That's any hands up, so I'm just going to move that we agree the recommendation. Seconded by Councillor Rowe. Thank you. You all agree by assent. Just before I deliver the news that this meeting has come to a close, I want to just put on record that I appreciate the way tonight's meeting has been discussed on the basis. It's not an easy one. This process has been far from easy. It's been absolutely horrendous if the truth be told. So this is a bit of a landmark. It's not particularly a great landmark, but it's a landmark and it is significant. So I just want to thank everyone who's participated.